a part of AFO Records All for One, the historic African-American label here in New Orleans. Before that, Jump Jazz from Louis Jordan and his Timpani 5. Louis went his own horn on vocals. An alto sax, choo-choo, chaboogie. Louis Jordan was a major influence on our guest, Charles Neville, the Neville Brothers, a saxophonist, arranger, and thinker in his own right. Charles grew up in a musical house and neighborhood in uptown New Orleans. He ran with Mardi Gras Indians, played in R&B combos, with musicians black and white alike across the divided New Orleans. He told me what made family life special.
It was the old TV.
And so when people came to visit, someone brought them out like, and so whatever the gathering was, it turned into a musical kind of celebration.
How fast it starts is from
the... dancing was really a group and even a family kind of thing that could be done.
It's okay, there is an external gratitude.
Just started here.
Black bottom, one called Snake Hips, of course there were the
jitterbug
and
Cakewalk. And people would play these on horns, tambourines, banjo, drums, whatever.
Kind of horn person. They had a guitar. Everybody had a guitar.
This is a big one. This is nice.
Let's talk about a few of the artistic and moral leaders and forces in your family. You had this man named Uncle Jolly. People refer to him as Chief Jolly, I guess, because he's a Mardi Gras Indian.
No. You know, he was like this really kind of mysterious figure in our early days of New York, because he wasn't in a family like we were with, two parents and some kids. He was alone, and then there were times when we'd meet a girlfriend of his. But he was a great dancer, and he knew about the music.
Boy, yeah,
but he was someone that we wanted to emulate because he was hip. He dressed hip. He walked hip. He talked hip. He said he started masking with the migraines in the early 60s. And just made a costume and went out there.
A child that doesn't really write and do is supposed to have the golden bank, man. It's supposed to be the best. Because as the song goes, the real white and blue
A lot of people refer to New Orleans as a spiritual city. They talk about Catholicism, they talk about voodoo, they talk about all manner of saints. How would you characterize the spirit world of New Orleans in your own life?
For me, it was a mixture of both the Christian, the Catholic, the Protestant, and the voodoo. My grandmother told me I was born with a veil over my face, which meant that I would be able to see spirits. And for a long time I did. And I got to meet some of the people who were named Mother this or Doctor that, and they were practitioners of the Yoruba voodoo, as well as members of those churches that were called the Holiness Churches. And the practices in those churches, though they were Christian, were pretty much all when I was in Haiti. And the thing that in the Haitian ceremony, the people called possession. In New Orleans, when I started in church, and there are always the stories about, you could go to someone if you wanted to put something on somebody, or they had certain kinds of candles.
some kind of negative energy burning the black candle. And I remember being told that, well, if you take
out of their families, you know, the way things were in the South, the kind of jobs available to black men were not as lucrative as the jobs available to black women. So in a lot of cases, they were actually the breadwinners, and in the cases where their husband was working somewhere, he was gone all the time. So the kids were under the care of the matriarch. And my father was in and out because he and Jolly were they called Pullman porters. So they were going on the trains for a while. The seamen, they were in and out.
They were traveling men.
Yeah, which was something that I always thought of as something that I wanted. Because they brought back these wonderful stories about the places they had been, what things they had seen that were so different from what we saw in our neighborhoods.
This Valence Street neighborhood sounds almost like a family and kids paradise.
Yeah, it really was. And, you know, aside from the people in the family, there were entertainment. We got to know one of the entertaining icons of New Orleans, Patsy Valance.
Well, she was the lady at the Dewdrop, or the kind of cross dresser at the Dewdrop.
Yeah, and you know, so there were lots of entertainers who visited Patsy as well. Mother and my uncle, who were dancers, danced with Louis Prima's band as part of his show for a while.
It's every time it rains, and it's from heaven. Don't you know each cloud contains band is from heaven?
What is it that gets you motivated enough to become a musician?
For me, there was never any question about it that, I knew music somehow. From as early as I can remember. My grandmother sang all the time in the house with whatever kind of chore was happening. There was a song to go with it. I remember being with her sitting in the kitchen helping her shell peas, and there was a song that we sang while that was happening. You know, in the movies back then in the 40s, there were these musical shorts that were like music videos now. And Louis Jordan was one of the main artists who had, he had the most of those, it seems. And I saw him playing saxophone and singing. It looked like he was having so much fun. I decided, man, that was absolutely.
Is there one really good Louis Jordan that sticks with you all these years?
Run Joe. Run Joe, any man that you told, Run Joe, the man won't let me go.
Tell me all about it, Giant.
When Joe had a candy store, telling fortune behind the door, got grabbed Mo, and as Joe ran out, Brother Mo then began to shout, Run Joe, yeah.
That's Louis Jordan in comedic Caribbean style, just like in between acts. A big part of Charles Neville's musical childhood. We're coming up with Charles and American Roots Returns.
Thank you.
I'm Nick Spitzer. This is American Roots with Cosmic Saxophones, continuing our conversation with Charles Neville, who brought us down to earth with memories of life and music in Jim Crow New Orleans.
Yeah, it was very segregated, but also the neighborhood we lived in was mixed. In the Capitol Project, there was an Italian-owned store, and my grandmother worked for that family. So we got to know the people in that family. So there was like mixing and mingling, unless that we were being observed by outsiders, then we had to keep the image of separation.
This is amazing to imagine that this level of intimacy within this segregated world.
You know, part of the separation thing was that a lot of were against the law for black and white musicians or entertainers to perform together in New Orleans. And probably all over the South. And, you know, there were white musicians who went to jail from the Dewdrop for being caught on stage with the black band. And there was a club we played at in the French Quarter after hours when the joint closed. The closed sign on, locked the door, and patron people would stay in. And the black and white musicians would get on stage and jam until the sun came up.
So they had to close the door, make it unofficial, unpublic, to then do what people were just going to probably do naturally.
Right.
Reality is a word. Some people don't understand. They make their whole life living on make-believe land.
It was the early 60s and late 50s when the Playboy Club came in. And I got the gig at the Playboy Club with Little Snooks. We had a trio, myself, Snooks Eglin, and a drummer, Clarence Brown, who played with the Fats Domino for many years. It was still against the law for black and white patrons to be in the same place, but that was a private key club, so they couldn't stop that.
Wake up, oh, wake up, and face reality. I think you were the first brother to actually get out of New Orleans and play in the early 50s. You had a band you toured with, House Rockers.
Yeah, Gene Franklin and his House Rockers. It was playing with these seasoned musicians who I could ask questions of, you know, what do I do on this joint? Explaining how to play harmony with men, how to voice lead parts, and how to follow the singer, and how to play between words the singers were saying. But then there was also the dealing with the racism traveling on the road in the South as well. Lincoln Continental, and we're passing through Kissimmee, Florida, and pulled into a filling station to get gas, and there was a little general store with a and, you know, the oyster shell tribe, and we pulled up there, there was nobody out there, Larry blew the horn, the guy comes and said, yeah, what you boys want? And Larry said, well, fill it up for us, please. Yeah. And he goes around to the back of the car, and Lincoln Continental, the gas cap was under the license. Back the license plate was on a spring, and we heard it creaking. And he pulled it back, and then we heard it slam, close, bam. And he comes around to the driver's side of the car, unzipping his Texaco. He had a badge. He said, boy, I'm the deputy sheriff. I heard y'all speeding when you come in here. And we went, what? Heard us speeding. And he said, hey, sheriff. He called the guy in the general store, older guy. He said, come look at this. And they go around. Corner, I realized, okay, Larry's got a New York license plate, and he's got like a bumper sticker. It was on the trunk of the car that said, this vehicle is all blondes. So the guy from the store comes back around the side of the car and says, I'm the sheriff, y'all under arrest for speeding. So they take us into the little general store, and the guy who was the sheriff takes off his sheriff hat, puts on his black robe, takes his pistol butt and beats on the counter, bam, 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 here, the code is now in session. I hereby fine y'all $150 a piece for speeding. Bam.
Wow.
So Larry had to call New York to get him to wire the money. And, you know, back in those days, wires didn't come in 15 minutes. It took at least overnight. So they locked us up in the storeroom of the store while they waited for the money to come.
Good Lord.
And that was one of the milder of the experiences like that, you know.
Oh, y'all a moment. They keep creeping in my window.
if you tell me. Oh, if the girls ever come in.
Let me ask you about playing. Is there an advantage to working with a band of brothers?
There's a definite advantage to working with the band of brothers. My uncle called about doing the recording of Wild Chopper told us. And I went down and we went in the studio and just started playing. And it happened. The music came out like magic and there was this plan we didn't have to talk about. Well, who's going to take the third? Who's going to sing together? And it blended. We start off and the energy is just flowing through us on stage. And then from us, it goes out into the audience, flows through the people, and it comes back to us. And, you know, that's like just the greatest feeling, you know. The band's music was great and the feeling was great, but nothing like playing with the family.
Yeah, you live in a different world up there. What about the next generation, though, with your own kids and other family members? If you're not in the Valence Street neighborhood, how can there be another generation of music that carries the tradition forward? Is that important to you?
Oh, yeah, it is. Well, you know, that's the oldest of my young kids is playing cello and piano. The little one is into the drums right now, but he likes the saxophone as well. You know, and I think it can be nurtured within the household as well as within the community.
That's Charles Neville and his brother.